Okay, welcome you all to this 10th session of this course, and in total there will be 11 sessions. So today is the second last session. We'll have one more session over the next weekend, and there might be a tutorial session on 17th as well. Not very sure as of now, but I will make the announcement. Now, regarding few more announcements that I've already made on the portal, your quiz 2 has been uploaded and it will be open from 5th November, that is tomorrow, till 20th November. So it's a long duration of 15 days for which the quiz is open. Quiz 2, it's of 2 marks, and it will be open from 5th November till 20th November. The second announcement is regarding assignment, phase 2 of the assignment. So phase 2 of the assignment is also uploaded. It's not as rigorous as the phase 1, so it's a small portion which only covers design patterns. You need to identify 2 gang of 4 design patterns and 2 grasp design patterns and show how these patterns are applicable in the case study that you had chosen earlier in phase 1. One thing important that you have to keep in mind is that you have to stick to the same groups as were there in the phase 1. Please do not change the groups. Further details regarding what has to be done in the phase 2 assignment is given in the document, and the last date of submission of the phase 2 assignment is 20th November. There will be no extension for submission of phase 2 because we already have exams starting from 24th November, right? So 24th and 25th are the exams, and then 1 week break is there, and then we have the makeup exams, right? So immediately once the phase 2 submission is over after 20th, we would start with the vivas. And request you not to put in request to reschedule the vivas because it's only a duration of 15 days in which we would have to conduct all the vivas. So that by the time the makeup answer sheets are evaluated, the assignment evaluation is also completed. Right, so it's going to be a tight schedule for you as well and for the persons evaluating the assignment as well. So please try not to request for rescheduling of vivas, etc. There are a few questions that I take up. Makeup exams are 2 weeks after the regular exam. No, I think it's after 1 week. So there's 1 weekend gap and then the makeup exams are there. We would definitely have a viva for the assignment, which would be a combined viva for phase 1 as well as phase 2. The question is, when would be the makeup result for the mid-semester exam be out? 3rd November was the last date for evaluation of the makeup answer sheets. So whatever pending would be there would definitely be covered by Monday, I assume, and then by Tuesday or Wednesday you would have the result of the makeup examination as well. Also, please be on lookout for recheck. So once you have gone through your answer sheets, in case you have a recheck request, you need to apply through the same portal from which you are able to view the evaluated answer sheets. Recheck is open, so you can apply in case you want to do the same. Okay, this is a question about viva, so let me just take that up. So group viva and individual viva. So it will be a group viva right, one group would be given a slot of say 15 to 20 minutes and all would be requested to log in at the same time and then the Viva would be conducted. Won't there be any postpone of examination dates? No. No postponement of the examination dates. Examination dates are fixed and it's because it happens at a very large scale, so there is no postponement of the examination dates. The venues are fixed, the venues have been booked for the exams, so there will be no change. I think that's it for today. No more questions I see. Okay. In case you have certain queries other than this, you can write a mail to me and I would try and reply to them. In case you are traveling, please, you'll have to manage it at your own level. You be online for the Viva, that can be done, but for the written examination, you have to come and give the examination in person. Viva is online, so you can attend even if you are outside, right? Okay, let us start today. So today we are going to start with the GRASP patterns. We did the Gang of Four design patterns in the last two sessions, and we saw a lot of implementation along with those patterns, how to implement those patterns. Now today we will see the GRASP patterns. Okay. GRASP stands for General Responsibility Assignment Software Patterns, right? So it's an acronym. GRASP is an acronym which stands for General Responsibility Assignment, right? The key word to pick up from this acronym is responsibility assignment. So these software patterns are based on the concept of assignment of responsibility, right? So they are based or they are driven on responsibility. So they follow a approach which is called responsibility driven approach or RDT, right? So let's try and understand what do we actually mean by responsibility and what is responsibility driven approach, right? Software objects have a responsibility which is an abstraction of what they do, right? So every software object, every software class is responsible for doing certain tasks, right? And that is at an abstract level, if you talk about it, it is the responsibility of the class. Responsibility is essentially of two types: doing responsibility and knowing responsibility, right? Let's see what do we mean by doing responsibility and knowing responsibility. Doing responsibility of an object includes doing something itself, right? Such as, for example, creating an object or doing some calculation, or it might be initiating action in other objects, or say for example, controlling and coordinating activities in other objects, right? So doing responsibility of an object is something that it does. Either it does a calculation, an initiation action, a creation action, right? Now a question comes is that does the methods of the action let us know, the methods of the class let us know what are the doing responsibility of the object? We could say yes, they do help, right? But in the abstraction level, at the abstract level, we cannot say that methods are the responsibilities of the object, but methods are something that helps an object to complete its responsibilities, right? Methods are in a way realization of those responsibilities that an object has, right? Directly we cannot say that the methods are the responsibilities of the object, because responsibilities are at an abstract level. It is the methods that facilitate in doing the responsibilities, but they themselves cannot be defined as the responsibilities, right? So doing responsibility of an object is something that the object does. Let's see what is the knowing responsibility. The knowing responsibility of an object is the knowledge that the object stores within itself, right? So that knowledge can be in the form of encapsulated data that it has, knowledge about related objects that it has, right, and knowledge about things it can do, right? So knowing responsibility is about the knowledge that the object has with it, its capabilities, the information that the object stores within it. And this doing and knowing responsibility is what helps us to decide which object should do what. And the grasp patterns are based on this responsibility approach. The grasp patterns help us, or they tell us, that if this particular object needs to do this, it should have this responsibility. Or in other words, an object having this responsibility will be responsible for doing this particular task, right? Just to remind, a responsibility is not the same thing as method. It's an abstraction, right? But methods help objects to fulfill its responsibilities. Here's a list of the 9 grasp patterns that we are going to take a look at today. And these are the 9 grasp patterns that are there in your course, right? So there is creator, low coupling, high cohesion, pure fabrication, protected variations, information expert, controller, polymorphism, and indirection. Right, so these 9 grasp patterns, and in total, actually, there are 9 grasp patterns in total, and all the 9 are there in your course, and we're going to have a look at these patterns in today's lecture. Okay, let's move ahead. There are questions coming up, I'll take up slowly. Okay, there's a question, what is the meaning of knowing about related objects, right? So knowing means the information that it stores, a particular object stores about the other object, right? What all information about the other object is stored within this particular object, right? This is the knowing responsibility of the object. As we move ahead with the examples, you will be able to understand these responsibility concepts in a more detail. Let me take up the first pattern and then we'll see how do we go about it. So the first pattern, the first grasp pattern that we take up is the creator pattern, right? The problem that this creator pattern aims to address is that who should be responsible for creating a new instance of some class, right? So given a case study, right, now once, say for example, you are through with the design model, you need to decide that there is this particular design class, who should be responsible, which particular class should be responsible for creating instances of class X, right? The solution that is provided by the creator pattern. Let's understand the solution. Assign class B the responsibility to create an instance of class A if one of these is true, the more the better, right? So in order to assign class B the responsibility to create instances of A, we look for these four options, right? And the more the numbers are true, the more we are in favor of class B, that class B should be responsible for creating instances of class A. The first option is B contains a compositely aggregate A. Right. So if you remember, we did an aggregation and a composition kind of relationship that exists between classes or objects. So if B contains or aggregates A, then B is something that should be responsible for instantiating objects of A. Right. If B records A, if B is responsible for recording A, right? By recording A, we means that if B is responsible for updating information in A, then again B should be responsible for instantiating objects of A. The other option might be B closely uses A. Right, so if B is has a high coupling with A, right, so it closely uses A, it invokes methods of A very frequently, right, then we say B closely uses A, so then in that case B should be responsible for instantiating objects of A. The fourth option is B has the initializing data for A that will be passed to A when it is created. Thus, B is also an expert in creating A. Right? Since B has the data which is required to create A, it becomes obvious that B should be responsible for creating A rather than B passing that initialization data to C and then asking C to instantiate objects of A. Right? However, if more than one option applies and there is a tie, right? So in case you find that there is a tie, so suppose B compositely aggregates A, but it is C which has the initializing data for A, then you go in favor of the class which aggregates or which compositely aggregates or contains class A, right? So if B compositely aggregates objects of A and C has initializing data for initializing A, then your vote would be in favor of B because it compositely aggregates A, right? The main reason, if you try and understand, would be because like for example we studied aggregation, so for example hand is an aggregation of fingers, right? So it is hand which should be responsible for creating objects of fingers, because as soon as the object of hand is destroyed, the objects of fingers also have to be destroyed, right? It should not be that the object of hand is destroyed and then a message is sent to another class to destroy objects of finger, right? So the highest preference is given to a class which compositely aggregates the other class to instantiate objects of that particular class, right? This has the highest advantage. Although if there is tie at the other, in other cases, suppose there is the condition 1 doesn't hold at all and B records A, and then you might find that C closely uses A and D has the initializing data, right? Then other design patterns would help you to solve the problem, right? So then in that case you will take help, because your creator pattern doesn't help you to provide enough information. You will make use of the other patterns to solve the issues, right? so that your cohesion of the class remains high and coupling is low. Right? In this particular instance itself, you can see that the fourth option says that if B has the initializing data for A that will be passed to A when it is created, then B should be responsible for creating A because B is an expert. Right? So in this case, B is an information expert in creating A. Right? So information expert is the next pattern that we go to see. Right? So these patterns, they are designed in such a way that they would help you easily in choosing between alternatives as to if this is not true, which should be the one that is true. Right? I will take a few examples now from the snakes and ladders case study. Right? So just to quickly remind you of what the snakes and ladders case study was, this was a customized game of snakes and ladders. One of the main concept was that the game owner had the right to configure the board and place snakes and ladders at different positions. Right? So he can even choose a number of snakes and ladders that are to be placed along with the position. Then if you remember, the game owner was responsible for inviting the players to join the games, join the game, and there were some issues with the way in the mode in which the game has to be played. Right? So the game could be played in multiple modes. So this was something that was there. The game could be played either in even odd mode. Right? So if it is in even mode, all the players if a particular player is in even mode, then if he gets an even number on his dice, that particular player moves his coin. And if a player is in odd mode, then wherever he gets an odd number on his dice, then only he would move the coins, right? Then there was a multiple coins mode. In snakes and ladders, there is a multiple coin mode, so a player can choose to play with multiple coins, either 2 to 4 coins, but at the same time all the players should have the same number of coins, right? And there was a hybrid mode, right? So continuing with this particular example, this particular case study, let's try and answer a few questions related to the creator pattern. I've got the domain model here, so we'll just move ahead. Okay, so this is one question that we can ask ourselves. In the snakes and ladders example, who should be responsible for creating the objects of the snake class? Right? So using the creator pattern, can you tell who should be responsible for creating the objects of the snake class? Okay, so one answer is the board game should be responsible. So if you, I would just go back to our the model that we had. So this was the model that we had drawn initially, right? So we had a game owner who was responsible for configuring the board, and the snakes and ladders were placed on the board, right? Looking at this model, looking at this diagram, now using the creator pattern, the question is, who should be responsible for creating the objects of the snake class? Right? The answer is, the board class should be responsible for creating the objects of the snake class. Let's try and understand this why. Okay? The main reason being is that The snakes and ladder objects are a part of the boat, right? It is the boat that aggregates the snakes and ladders, right? There's a request to go back to the diagram. I'll go back to the diagram, right? So this is the diagram we had drawn, right? And if you see very rightly, the game owner has the data or has the rights to configure the boat, right? So in a way, we can say, based on the creator pattern, it is the information expert is the game owner. So game owner might be the one who's responsible for configuring the board and might have the initial data for initializing the board, right? And in turn, the snakes and the ladder, right? But because the board class aggregates snakes and ladders objects, the board class would be responsible for creating the objects of snakes and ladders, right? It will not be the game owner or the game controller, right? So here the game domain object that you see this is actually the game controller. So your game controller or the game owner in this case would not be responsible for creating objects of the snake or the ladders. It would be the boat, because the moment the boat is destroyed, snakes and ladders objects have to be destroyed, right? And it is the boat which comprises of the snakes and ladders, and that is what the creator pattern says, that the first option, which says that if a class B contains or compositely aggregates A, then that class is the one that gets the first responsibility of initializing instances of class A, right? So in this case, the board class will be responsible for initializing objects of snakes as well as ladders, right? Let us see the other question. Okay, the next question is, who should be responsible for creating the objects of the dice class? Okay, there are questions. Go to the diagram. Okay, I'll just go wait. Okay, I'll just go to the diagram. So who should be responsible for creating the objects of the dice class? Okay, slowly you're coming close to it. So it will be the game controller who should be responsible for creating the instances of the dice class, right? We will not give player class the responsibility to create instances of dice class. It will be the game controller, right? It is not even the game owner. See, even if you don't go according to the pattern, still logically you can make out. The game owner and the player are entities which are supposed to do a particular task, right? So in order to increase the cohesion of these particular classes, so that based on their name itself, they are able to check in their responsibility and do whatever they are just desired to do, player class will not be responsible for creating instances of the dice class, right? You, while creating, while designing the objects, you must keep in mind that the cohesion of the class should be high. Class is not doing any unrelated tasks, right? And that is the reason, although player closely uses dice, player will not instantiate the object of the dice, because the dice is also a part of the game. The only if the game exists will only the dice exist, right? So it is the game controller which instantiates the dice, because as soon as the game shuts down or the game instances of game controller are gone or deleted, the instances of dice also have to be deleted, right? So game controller is responsible for creating instances of the dice class. Okay, I'll just take up a few questions. What is the difference between the game owner and the controller? So there is a there was a domain concept which was there given in the case study, that there is a game owner who is also a player, right? But he has an additional task of configuring the board, the game board. So once the game owner configures the game board, then he invites other players to come and play the game. However, the game controller was the main controller class, the system controller class, which was responsible for creating, for controlling the entire game system, right? So this was our game controller. So this is the difference between the game owner and the game controller. Okay, I've explained why the player will not be responsible for creating the instances of the dice class, right? Another important thing that I would like to add here is that each of these patterns, they are related to each other, right? You might feel that this particular aspect holds true because you are applying the creator pattern, but you might find that at the same time you are also applying the high cohesion pattern as well as the low coupling pattern, right? So all these patterns go hand in hand, right? And if there is a question, now this is important thing to understand, if there is a question and the answer is based on multiple patterns, right? So suppose you say that this particular class will be created by this particular class and the answer is this pattern, and there are multiple true answers, you would definitely get marks for all the correct answers, right? So it is not one pattern that might be in play at a particular time in order to decide which particular class will do that particular task, right? But of course, one pattern has more role to play, right? So in that case, if one pattern has a more role to play in order to decide which particular class will carry out that particular responsibility, then of course that particular answer will have the highest marks, right? But there would still be partial marking than in case there are patterns which you identify which also lead to the same solution, right? But the idea is you are able to explain how that particular pattern applies to that particular case. In case you are able to explain correctly, you would definitely get more than partial marks. Um, Okay, one question. In this particular case, can you make out if any gang of four pattern can be applied here? Okay, you can apply the singleton pattern here, right? So most of the time we see that the controllers are always singleton, right? So in this particular case, the game or the game controller would be a singleton, right? So this one gang of four pattern is what that can be applied in this particular case, right? Okay, another option that says is that board is also singleton. Do we go for board as being a singleton? Yes, of course, we can have board as a singleton. Yes, there in a particular game, there has to be only a single board, right? So board would also be a singleton in this case. Okay, so there is a question, if more pattern, you mean to say if there are more patterns that can be applied, we have to mention all of them, otherwise partial marks will be given. No. It's the other way around that I'm trying to say. I'm trying to say if given a case, there would be one pattern that would be the best fit, right? So that is the one that is best determining or best answer for that particular case. That in case you have written that particular answer, you get full marks. But if you have not written the best answer, right, but there are, you've mentioned about some other pattern which also might play a good role and result in the same answer, then you might get partial marks, right? So it would not be a flat zero. Right, so if there are more than one patterns which are acting and leading to the same answer, and if you have not got the best pattern as the answer, you've got the second best pattern as the answer, and if you are able to explain that correctly, then you would get partial marks. I'll just take up a few more questions. Okay, so there's a question, can we use factory to create multiple instances of snakes and ladders, right? The factory pattern is used in the case when the objects are of different types. Right, so for example, in our cake factory that we studied, there are different kind of cakes that have to be created, right? Whereas in this case, the snakes, all the snakes are of type snake itself, right? It is only the starting point and the ending point that is changing, right? So factory pattern doesn't hold good here. There is in fact no need of creating a factory pattern. You would just create an array of objects of snakes and an array of objects of ladders, right? Would it have been that there are 10 kinds of ladders that can be created and there are 10 kinds of snakes that can be created, then in that case we would make a factory here and then get objects of those different kinds from the particular snake factory or ladder factory. Okay. Again, can't we use a factory pattern for the board? You do not need a factory pattern for the board, right? So your factory pattern is only when you have a variety of objects to be created, each of which has the same behavior, and you get to know only at the runtime which particular type is required, right? The board doesn't have a variety, and in this case the board will be a singleton, right? So you will not need a factory here. Right, factories are implemented as singleton, but it is the other way round is not always true. Right, so whatever is a singleton may not be a factory. We need it to be a singleton because only one instance of that class is required in the particular system. So in this case, what is the best fit case? Grasp, creator, or singleton, right? So that depends on the question. Okay, if the question is who should be responsible for creating the objects of the snake class and the answer is board, then definitely it is the grasp creator pattern which plays the role here, right? If my question would have been how many instances of game controller would be there in this particular case? How would you decide that? Or which design pattern would you use to decide that? Right? Then in that case, your answer would be that this would be implemented as a singleton. Right? So you have to be very careful about when you read the question and try to find out actually what is the which particular category of pattern or which particular pattern is the one the question is indicating towards. Okay, because the moment I say creating objects, it actually starts pointing towards the creator pattern. I'll just take up a few questions. Okay, I am not very comfortable with this question. Snakes and ladders can use iterator pattern. You want to iterate through the various snakes and ladders. You might want to use an iterator pattern in this case, but see, iterator pattern is like you want to iterate through the same, I don't see different kind of iterations that might be done through the snakes array or the ladders array, right? So it would be a single linear iteration that would be done through the snakes array or the ladders array that would be there. But in case you think, please justify, right, if you think that different kind of iterators would be required to iterate through the snakes array and the ladders array, right? So for the snakes array that might be created and the ladder array that might be created, you might want to implement an iterator. You'll have to be you have to explain why you think that is, right? But for the snake class, it is not an aggregation of various objects. It's a standalone class, right? The snake class only has two attributes: the start point of the snake and the end point of the snake. This one snake object will represent a particular single snake on the board, right? So it's an array. The aggregation is created within the board class, but if you want to convert it into an iterator and then have a iterator pattern applied on it, guess if you feel that is required, then you should back up with possible reasons why you think it is correct. Okay, let us move ahead. Okay, yes, I have one more question for the same question. Who is responsible for creating the objects of the snake class? And the question is, why is not the factory pattern the best fit here? Right, the factory pattern is not the best fit here because snake doesn't have different types of snakes that are existing in this system. Right, it is a particular kind of snake that we have existing in the system. It is not C snake, P snake, Y snake, X snake. Right, it's a single kind of snake. If the case study would have been complicated by saying that the look and feel of the snakes are also different, right, and they are drawn in a different manner, one is a water snake, one is a viper, and then that way, then you would have gone for a factory to give you a viper and give you a cobra and things like that, right? But in this case, all the four snakes, all the 10 snakes, whatever the number of snakes might be, they are all instances of the same snake class. So factory pattern does not hold here, right? In this particular case, the factory pattern is incorrect, right? Because factory pattern applies when you have types of objects that can be created. All of them have the same behavior, but their individual types are different. Right? So you had pineapple cake, you had vanilla cake, you had butterscotch cake, etc. Whereas that is not the case here. All of them are snakes objects. Right? Let us move ahead, and otherwise we'll get stuck on the board class and the snakes itself. Okay, so we saw also who should be responsible for creating the objects of the dice class. So this question also we discussed that it is the controller responsible for creating the objects of the dice class. So this was creator pattern. Let's move ahead and take up the next pattern, which is the information expert. Right. So the problem this particular pattern tries to address is that what is the general principle of assigning responsibility to the objects? Right. Based on what principle do we decide or should we decide that this particular object should be responsible for doing this particular task? And the information expert pattern helps us to solve this problem. It says assign responsibility to the information expert. That means assign responsibility to the class that has the information necessary to fulfill the responsibility. Right? So if there is a class which has the information which is required to fulfill that particular task, make that particular class do that particular task. Right? Let us try and understand this again with a few questions. So these are the questions. Let's see the first one. So again, in the snakes and ladders example, who should be responsible for finding whether the tail or mouth of a snake has been reached after a move, right? So once a coin has been moved on the board, right, and say if you have landed on 53, who should be responsible to find whether to stay here or you have to move from 53, right? So if you have landed on the mouth of a snake, then you have to move. If you have landed on the tail of a ladder, you have to move, right? So who should be responsible for deciding whether the tail or mouth of a snake or a ladder has been reached after a move? Okay. So I think most of you are very close to it. Okay, so the majority is there. It is the boat class which should be responsible for finding whether the tail or the mouth of a snake has been reached. Why? Because the boat class has the information of all the snakes. Right? It is the boat class which is the information expert in this particular case. The boat class would quickly query each snake object and find out whether it is either the mouth of a snake has been reached or not, right? And also it will query all the ladder objects to find out whether the starting point of the ladder has been reached. Right, so if the starting point of the ladder has been reached, then the player has to climb up, and if the mouth of the snake has been reached, then the player has to fall down. Right, so since it is the boat class which has the information about all the snakes and the ladders, it is the information expert in this case and hence should be responsible for finding whether a tail or a mouth of a snake has been reached or not, right? And this is the kind of explanation you are expected to write in the examination. So apart from mentioning the kind of pattern, the reason why that pattern is applicable here and the reason why that one is the best suited for a particular case, right? So if you say board class, then it has to be backed up by the pattern and why this is the best answer. Right, so this is what you must explain. Right, let us come to the next question. Who should be responsible for knowing whether a player operates in even mode or odd mode? The question is, who should be responsible for knowing whether a player operates in even mode or odd mode? Okay, so there's a request to go back to the game, the domain model. Let me just check the slide that it is on so I can actually go back easily. So it's on 8. Okay, so here it is. This is the domain model. You need to find out who should be responsible for knowing whether a player operates in even mode or the odd mode. Right, and I go back to the slide. So there seems to be a tie. Most of you are, some of you say it should be the game owner. So it's almost 50-50. And the others say it should be the game or what you call as the game controller. Right, so either game owner or the game controller is the one who should be responsible for knowing whether a player operates in even or odd mode. Right, but if you see here, the game owner himself is also a player. And if I make game owner store information about the modes, who will store the information about the mode in which the game owner is playing. Right? So it is the game controller who is actually the information expert in terms of storing the information about modes of each player. The modes have to be stored at a central location where the information about every player's mode is stored. Game owner is also a player. Game owner also operates in a particular mode, right? So it should be the game controller who should actually store information or is responsible for knowing what is the mode for each player as well as what is the mode for the game owner, right? And these design patterns actually help you to go ahead and implement your given design, right? So it's like once you decide responsibilities at the abstract level, then at the implementation level, you know that this particular responsibility is of this particular class, and hence this particular class should have a method to implement that particular responsibility, right? And then hence you know, you get to know what are the methods that this particular class should implement, right? So it is the game controller which stores or which is the information expert in storing the modes of all the players including the game owner. Game controller, okay, there's a question. Game controller is the superset for holding all information, is it or not? Yes, of course, the game controller is the one who's responsible for holding all the information, right? But the game controller cannot do all the tasks on him, on itself, right? So it has to delegate tasks depending upon the situation, right? Okay, let us take up the next question. Who is responsible for knowing whether a coin has crossed the 100th square or not? Who should be responsible for knowing whether a coin has crossed the 100th square or not, right? So if a coin crosses the 100th square, then the player does no longer need to move. The coin no longer needs to move. And if there is only a single coin for that player, then of course the player would win, right? But who should be responsible for knowing whether a coin has crossed the 100th square or not? Okay, so there are majorly three options, three answers that I'm getting. The board, the game controller, and the player, right? So let us first see whether player should be the one who should be responsible for knowing whether a coin has crossed the 100th square or not. So does the player stores the information where a coin is at present? The answer is no, right? So player, based on the information expert, does not know the current location of a coin, right? So it is either the board or it is the game controller who would be knowing the current position of a coin, right? So who would be responsible for finding out whether a coin has crossed the 100th square or not? Whether it is the boat or the game controller, right? So actually, if you see, there's a tie in this particular case. The question falls back to another question. Actually, the answer falls back to another question is, and that question is, who is responsible for creating instances of coin objects? Right, so this was one question which somebody had asked in chat, and I did not take it up that time at the time of the creator pattern, but this is what has to be answered now, right? Who is or who should be responsible for creating instances of coin objects, right? One answer could be it would be the board class. Why? Because coin objects are placed on board, right? So in a way you could think that board consists or comprises of coin objects, which in a way might not be true as well, right? And there could be a possible solution that the game controller is responsible for creating instances of coin objects, right? So there are coins which are to be created by the game controller, right? This is one question which is pretty tricky to answer. You can continue to think about it. There is no wrong answer for this question. There is no right answer for this question, right? But eventually you would actually find out the best answer for this question if somebody would actually go and try and implement this, right? But nevertheless, whatever the tie may be, okay, if the board is responsible for creating the instances of the coin object, then board should be responsible for knowing whether a coin has crossed the 100th square or not. Alternatively, if the game controller is responsible for creating the instances of the coin object, then the game controller should be responsible for knowing whether a coin has crossed the 100th square or not. Right? So we do see that there is a tie here, and let's keep this question in mind and we try and see that if there is some other pattern that helps us to get answer to this particular question as to who should be responsible for creating instances of the coin objects. Okay, there's a request for a break. I need a break, so let me just stop the recording and we'll go for a 5-minute break here.